Real estate news now. Double Dragon begins construction of its Hotel 101 project in the Bridgetown district of Libis after securing the necessary permits. The hotel, which is envisioned to be the largest of its kind in Quezon City, is projected to be completed by the year 2026. The 702-room hotel is expected to generate 4.9 billion pesos in unit sales revenues. As for Megawide, it eyes acquiring its sister firm, PH One World Developer, from their parent firm, Citicore Holdings. The purchase price, 5.2 billion pesos. Megawide's board of directors green-lighted the move, but it is still subject to the approval of its stockholders at the company's stockholders' meeting scheduled next week. President Marcos expects the Philippines to have more stable and affordable energy with the expanded development of the Malampaya gas field and the blending of imported liquefied natural gas. He made that statement after a meeting with top officials of Enrique Razon's Prime Energy Resources Development in Malacañang. The energy operator discussed its plans to explore and develop indigenous gas prospects as well as supplement the local production with LNG imports. Marcos, meanwhile, welcomed Prime Energy's plan to commence drilling on Malampaya in the last quarter of 2024. The Malampaya Consortium will start drilling off the waters of Palawan by as late as 2024, then the start of production of natural gas from that area by 2026. Now, that statement from Philippine Energy Secretary Rafael Otilia, after the gas project's contract was renewed by the government for another 15 years.
This good news is important in terms of encouraging more investments in exploration in the oil and gas sector. You see, the importance of natural gas to the country is that natural gas is going to provide a backup for the uncertainties, for instance, in the supply of renewables. What I mean by that is, by nature, solar and wind are intermittent. We need natural gas to complement or to make up for those volatilities. So, with those, we look forward, therefore, to a more stable supply for the country, especially in the power sector.
The energy chief is also confident the Philippines' pivot to nuclear energy will happen within this decade. Lotilia says his agency has been in close coordination with various agencies to study adding nuclear into the country's energy mix.
We have been at work with not only within the department, but within the different agencies of government, the Department of Science and Technology, the Philippine Nuclear Research Institute, and several others who have actually been looking at these things not only in recent years, but even in the years before. The Congress.
Now, exporters now have more options to ship their goods across Asia. The Subic facility of the International Container Terminal Services Incorporated, or ICTSI, is now providing a link between traders in the Philippines and southern China and Vietnam. Enrique Razon's port operator says the route will provide traders in northern and central Luzon more opportunities to help ferry agriculture and manufacturing exports. This is part of the company's recent initiatives to beef up operations. In May, ICTSI broke ground for a new berth at its Manila International Container Terminal. The Maharlika Investment Fund Bill now up for President Marcos's signature. The Palace has confirmed it received the proposed measure Tuesday. Marcos has said he will sign the controversial measure as soon as it reaches his office. The bill seeks to create the Philippines' first sovereign wealth fund. One of the bill's authors, Congresswoman Stella Quimbo, says the independent body that will handle the investment fund is expected to be created this year.
expect results overnight, but many of them, for example, within like 1 or 2 years, they started to make money. So yes, and remember that this involves projects, infrastructure projects, for example, big ticket items, which really requires lumpy capital. So you don't, of course, financial investments will also be part of it. So for the financial investments, we expect a return sooner, but then for other projects, those high yielding, big ticket projects, infrastructure projects, which we really need at this point in time, that will take a bit longer to produce. But that's setting up for sure this year. At the end of the day, it's really the people who would be in the corporation and what policies that these people would adopt that would spell the difference.
The Philippine Tourism Department is apparently sticking with its new slogan despite the controversy surrounding a promotional video that used stock footage of other countries. Speaking at an event this morning, Tourism Chief Cristina Frasco ended her speech using the new slogan, "Love the Philippines."
We are the Philippines. We have gone through so much as a nation. We possess the strength of spirit to continue, to prevail, and to overcome. The world has told us that there is so much to love about our country. And I'm fully confident that if all of us looks into the depths of our heart, we will find in each and every one of our fellow Filipinos that burning pride of place for the Philippines and that deep love of country. And therefore, it would serve all of us to unite and come together and show our deep love of country by continuing to champion Philippine tourism. Daghan kayong salamat kaninyong tanan. Love the Philippines.
The ad agency behind the promotional video, DDB Philippines, has apologized for the stock footage controversy. The performance of local airlines have improved in recent weeks following a string of flight delays and cancellations. That claim from the Manila International Airport Authority. It says local carriers improved punctuality after reducing their commercial flights by around 10 to 20% to cope with a shortage of planes and parts.
This is an interim reduction habang hinihintay nila itong mga spare parts na kailangan nila, the engines that they need, the new aircraft that they're expecting to arrive. Those are all part of the improvement plans, and isa pa doon na nire-require namin sa kanila is for them to have spare aircraft to support their schedules.
Climate advocates come together for the launching of a disaster risk reduction toolkit. Our correspondent Jervis Manahan is on the line for the details. Jervis?
Yes, Denise, environmental group Greenpeace Philippines launched their disaster risk reduction toolkit on Wednesday in time for the National Disaster Resilience Month. This aims to show the best practices in community collaboration in terms of disaster response. The toolkit comes in the form of a book featuring 11 case studies from LGUs, communities, and civil society organizations producing localized solutions in addressing climate risk. It hopes to engage the public in building their own resilient cities and communities and to encourage collaboration among government institutions, LGUs, and local community groups. Among the stories were bamboo-based starter home model, community-supported agriculture, and passing youth community pantry. It is downloadable to the public online. Denise.
Jervis Manahan with that story. Thanks, Jervis.